Okay, so I mean, I will first recall the state of the art as 1 year ago, and then I will explain the most recent result, which is called the quanta of geometry. And I mean, so what I want to explain, I mean, at the end of the day, what we shall see is an operator theoretic equation, which is a generalization of the Heisenberg commutation relation, and with the irreducible representations will give four manifolds and the gravity on these four manifolds coupled with the standard model, in fact, coupled with the minimal asymptotically free extension of the standard model, which is given by Patti-Salam model. But in order that you understand how these things came about, I will first recall, as I said, you know, the work which I did for several years with Ali Shamsuddin, and then more recent work with Walter, because this will give the general framework. Okay, so I mean, the idea is the following. The idea is that what we learn from physics is something which is bare data, and which is, if you want, the fact that as far as we know, physics is governed by two things. It's governed by general relativity, which can be expressed rather nicely by this Lagrangian, by this action functional, which is the integral of the scalar curvature. But of course, you need to know geometry in order to understand that. But I mean, there is an additional term, which is the matter term. And this matter term, if you want this standard model term, is not simple. I don't show it to you to scare you. I just show it to you so that you know what we are fighting with. So what we are fighting with is this Lagrangian, which has three pages. I won't spend much time about it, but you know, it is a condensate of an incredible amount of knowledge which physicists have acquired by a constant fight with experiment. So, I mean, it's not a fake thing. It's something which, among which, in fact, so here you have the, essentially the fermionic sector that you can see here. But you have terms like eight third and so on, which, you know, look very strange. Of course, it's related to the fractional charge of the quarks. And then in the page before, you have essentially the Higgs sector, which fortunately has now been found. So, I mean, here, for instance, you have the cubic term or the quartic term for the Higgs. Here, the quartic term for the Higgs and so on and so forth. So all of these terms are relevant. Moreover, what you have to know is that what I have written down here is the Lagrangian in flat space. So if one was writing the full story, there would be gravitational terms, and it would be the same Lagrangian but minimally coupled with gravity. And in fact, okay. So the idea is that we want to understand this stuff. And we want to express this very elaborate Lagrangian of gravity coupled with matter, so both of them. And what we want to do is to express it as pure gravity on the geometric space-time. So this was the first idea. Okay, this was the idea like that was still on 1 year ago, and where we didn't have yet the equation I will explain later. Okay. So now, I think Lars said this morning, you know, the universe is non-commutative, but let me tell you what is the reason behind this phrase. I mean, there is a very simple reason, which is that when you look at this beast, okay, when you look at this beast, which is the Lagrangian of gravity coupled with matter, then you find out that, okay, if you are conceptually minded, then it's better to look first at the group of invariants of this story. And when you look for the group of invariants of this story, what you find out is that the group is more interesting, more complicated than the group that you would get for gravity. For gravity, you would just get the group of diffeomorphisms of some manifold M. Okay. And of course, when you express this algebraically, this is the group of automorphisms of the algebra of smooth functions M. That's the same thing. Now, it turns out that because of the matter sector, it's not this group that you have as a group of invariants, but you have another piece of the story, and the other piece of the story are maps from the manifold M to a gauge group, okay, which is, and moreover, if you want, it's not the product of these two groups that you have, but it's a semi-direct product, because the diffeomorphism shuffles the gauge transformations of second kind. So what you have is a mixture of these two things, but it's a semi-direct product. Now, the first thing that you should do if you have a story like that, I mean, it's very natural to ask if there is a space. So is there a space X that we are looking for, and which would be such that this group here is equal to diff of X? Okay, because if we had such a space, then we could pretend that we are in fact doing pure gravity on this space. Okay. Now, what you can do is you can open any book of differential geometry, and you can browse through it, and you can look for diffeomorphism groups of manifolds and try to find a diffeomorphism group that looks like this, and you have no chance. I mean, of course, this is the idea of Kaluza-Klein, but the reason why you have no chance is that there is a theorem of, I think, John Mather, which tells you that when you take a group of diffeomorphism of any manifold, then the connected component of identity is a simple group. So it cannot be a semi-direct product, okay? Now, why is the non-commutative geometry there to solve this question? It's there because here we had automorphisms of a commutative algebra. But now if I take the automorphism group out of an algebra A, which is not commutative, okay, then it turns out that because the algebra is non-commutative, it does have automorphisms which are sort of innocent. And what are they? They are automorphisms. I am dealing with a star algebra. So they are automorphisms of the form X goes to UX U star, or UX U inverse. But let me say that we are in the star domain, so this is U star. And these automorphisms are called inner ones, and they form a normal subgroup of the group of all automorphisms, which are called inner automorphisms. And so, as soon as you move a little step in a non-commutative world, then you will find out that the group of diffeomorphisms has exactly the right structure, namely it does have a non-trivial normal subgroup, and the quotient by this normal subgroup acts, of course, as in a semi-direct product, okay? And so the first thing to do is to try this, and to try this, we can move in the simplest possible way to the non-commutative world, namely we can replace C infinity of M by K matrices of smooth functions. If you have k by k matrices of smooth functions, you can multiply them as you multiply matrices. And when you add and multiply functions, you add them and you multiply them as usual. Okay, you obtain in that way an algebra. And when you look at the group of inner automorphisms and so on, what do you find out? You find out that if you take this very simple example, then it's exactly the same group as what you would get if you would do gauge theory with gauge group SUN. Namely, if you take n by n matrices of smooth functions and you look at the exact sequence that you get from automorphisms and inner automorphisms, you get exactly the same exact sequence as you would have here when the group G is a group SUN. Okay? So this fact, very, very simple fact, if you want, is the essence of the idea that the fact that in the structure of physics we do have these internal symmetries is really the sign that we should move slightly to the non-commutative world, okay? So that's the idea. Now, what we did with Shamseddin a long time ago, we showed that when one studies pure gravity on the space where the algebra of functions is replaced by k by 3 matrices of functions, then what you obtain is you obtain a gravity but coupled, minimally coupled with the Hermite theory for the gauge group SUN. And now you can ask me, but how do you define gravity? Of course, you can ask me, how do you define gravity for such a space? And how do you define gravity? Well, to define gravity, you have to understand geometry. And to develop geometry for spaces whose coordinates do not commute, namely for which the algebra of coordinates is replaced by an algebra like this, then it turns out that what you find out is that the version of geometry that you obtain is no longer a version where you take points and you know you move and you take local coordinates and so on. No, you get a spectral version. And in that spectral version, this is what I explained in my last talk last time, the line element is in a better shape, actually, than the line element in the usual theory, because it's given by the propagator for fermions, and the distances are measured by another formula, which is a Kantorovich dual of the usual formula. So that's what you get. And as I explained last time, the theory begins to be looking like quantum. Namely, you have a dictionary. And in this dictionary, what you find out is that a lot of the classical notions have a replacement. And this replacement is in usual terms better. For instance, a real variable becomes a self-adjoint operator, but now infinitesimals are there. They coexist with real variables. The integral is replaced by the logarithmic divergency, and the line element is the fermion propagator. So this is what I said briefly last time. But so this leads you to what are called spectral triples, and so on, and spectral geometry, where, you know, as I said, you have all this stuff. Okay. Now, how do we get first of all, there is a little bit more structure than just the spectral triple. So just, if you want, the triple formed by the algebra, the Hilbert space, and the Dirac operator. And the reason is the following. So this is what is called the spectral triple. Okay. And the reason behind this is the following. The reason is that there is a reconstruction theorem. And the reconstruction theorem will tell you that for which spectral triple you will find an ordinary Riemannian manifold. Of course, the algebra A has to be commutative in that case. H will be the replacement for the Hilbert space of spinors and so on. But somehow what you find out is that it's quite important in that respect that there is a small decoration on H, which is called the real structure or the charge conjugation operator in physics. And I can tell you what is the meaning of this in mathematics. So in physics, this is called the charge conjugation operator. It's called J. Okay. Now, there is also, in the even case, there is also a chirality operator. And what is behind this? Well, what is behind this is the following. From the purely mathematical side, so as Lars explained this morning, there is topological case theory. Okay. But there was a great discovery which was done around the index theorem of Attia and Singer, done in part by Attia and then a lot of different people, Brown, Douglas, Fillmore, Kasparov, and all that, which is that there is a, when you look for the dual theory to case theory, so it will be, if you want, case theory is like a cohomology theory, but if you look for the corresponding homology theory, well, it turns out that this homology theory is best understood when you think of the algebra A, which is the algebra of continuous functions in the space X. It turns out that the dual theory, homology theory, is best understood in terms of Hilbert space representations, and that it's not the data of the operator D which matters, but it's the data of the operator D up to homotopy which matters. And that will give you the dual theory of complex case theory. And when you look at the work on what is a manifold, which was done in the 70s by Sullivan and many other people, when you want to understand what is a manifold, a smooth manifold, you find out that if you are given a Poincaré duality in ordinary homologies, this doesn't suffice, because a manifold has invariants, which are very important, which are the Pontryagin classes. And what you need to know is more. What you need to know is the fundamental class of the space in a theory which is finer, which is called KO homology. Now, this KO homology is finer than complex case theory exactly by this operator J. Okay, so it is exactly this operator J that allows you to refine the complex case theory to the KO homology. So this is the role that J is playing. And it turns out, so this J has three incarnations. It is, on the one end, the charge conjugation in physics. It is, on the other end, the refinement, the real refinement of complex case theory. And the third thing that it is, and this is very important, it's the Tomita. It's the Tomita J operator in operator algebras. So this is only relevant in the non-commutative case. And in the non-commutative case, what Tomita discovered is that if you take an algebra, self-adjoint algebra of operators in Hilbert space, then you can switch it to its commutant, provided you have mild conditions. You can switch it to its commutant by an anti-linear isometry. So this is the third role that it plays. Okay, so this J operator satisfies some commutation relations with respect to the chirality and with respect to the operator D, which is the Dirac operator. And this gives you three signs, and that tells you that K-homology, this theory which is here, in fact, it comes in eight forms. So if you want, in K-theory is periodic with period 2 complex K-theory, but K-theory is periodic of period 8. That's related to the periodicity of the Clifford algebras. Okay, so you have these 8 possible signs. And now, so what we discovered, so if you want, there were several interplays between experiment and this work that we did with Shamseddin. In 1996, we had already found that there was a way to write down the standard model which was compatible with this and so on and so forth. But then in 1998, the neutrino oscillation was discovered. And then we decided that everything could be thrown to the waste, to the thrash, you know. And why? Because we didn't have neutrino oscillations. And then, if you want, what happened was that for a long time, we were stuck until 2006. And in 2006, my collaborator, Mathilde Marcoli, sent me by email the formula that you saw at the beginning for the standard model. And she told me, okay, with Ali Shamseddin, you wrote a paper in which you say you find this formula. Can you explain how you find it? Okay. So I began to, because we were writing a book, so I began to try to prove every term very carefully and so on. And in this process, I discovered that, in fact, there was something that we had not looked into in 1996 in the work with Shamseddin, which is that we had assumed that the KO dimension of the space was the same as the metric dimension. You see, in non-commutative geometry, what you have the notion of metric dimension. Okay, and the metric dimension of the space is given by the growth of the eigenvalues of the line element of DS, the line element. In other words, in the calculus, which I showed you before, you know, an infinitesimal has an order. And the idea is that if you work, so in dimension alpha, what you will have is that DS to the power alpha is an infinitesimal of order 1. And that will tell you that you can integrate anything times ds to the alpha, okay? Now, so this is the metric dimension, but there is also another dimension which is coming from the KO dimension. And in our work with Shamseddin, what we had done was we had considered as a model for space-time the product of an ordinary manifold, M, by a slightly non-commutative space. So slightly non-commutative space, but which was finite. It was a finite space. What does it mean that the space is finite? It will mean that the corresponding algebra is finite dimensional. So that space was finite, okay? And but we had considered that because it was a finite space, it should have KO dimension 0, okay? And in the meantime, there were works like by a number of people, in particular by Gianni and many other people, where they were deforming an ordinary space like the sphere. And they did find out that there was a drop of the metric dimension. Namely, when you take the sphere, for instance, you deform it to the quantum sphere and so on, then the metric dimension of the space actually drops down from 2 to 0, for instance, for the two spheres. So it was clear that in that case, of course, the KO dimension doesn't change. So it was clear that there was then an independence between the two possible dimensions. And then, okay, in this process, I began to try other dimensions. And eventually, we found out with Shamseddin that the correct dimension which worked was 6. So in other words, the correct KO dimension of the finite space that we had to add was KO dimension 6. There are a number of reasons which I don't want to detail about this. So we looked and we found out that this space had to be a dimension 6. And then what we did, so that was a fine structure that was emerging. Because of this KO dimension 6, what was happening was that there was a neutrino mixing exactly in the right way. And we did the calculation, and discovered new terms in the Lagrangian. And these terms were exactly the CISO mechanism that were giving the small mass to the neutrinos. I didn't know what was the CISO mechanism, and it was found by computation. Okay, so that was a clear sign that we were on the right track. And then what we did with Shamseddin, we classified these finite spaces of given KO dimension. And we found out that there were essentially two cases. There was a case where the center of some algebra was equal to C, just one point, but there was also the case, very non-trivial case, where the center of some algebra was equal to C plus C. And it turned out that in KO dimension 6, this was the only permitted case. So the other case was not working. And then, okay, we classified, and with a little bit, but of course now this will be removed, with a little bit of choosing, then we were falling on the right thing for the standard model, which we found to be the algebra. So the algebra, which had the center, which was two pieces, had to be the following. It had to be, so the algebra A that we are putting for the finite space, so AF, if you want, had to be 2 by 2 matrices over quaternions, okay, plus 4 by 4 matrices of complex numbers. Okay, and we computed. What we did at that time, and we had computed how it was broken to the standard model, but it was a mathematical artifact and it was not really the final understanding. Okay, so before I move on, let me mention a very important other development. We did the reduction to the SM gauge group by pure mathematics, but then more recently, we found with Walter van Sollekom. What we found is the following. We found a way to do what are the inner fluctuations. So, you know, I explained to you what are the inner automorphisms. So we had inner automorphisms int, so inner automorphisms. Okay, and I did not explain that exactly as you have inner automorphisms which are contained in all automorphisms, okay, the metric has inner fluctuations. Okay, and at first, these inner fluctuations were, if you want, computed explicitly and so on by means of formula which were similar to the usual formula for differential forms. So they were defined by gauge potentials which were of the form sigma of A dB, commutator. These were reproducing the gauge potentials and so on. But we had not understood in depth what were these inner fluctuations, and we understood them in the work with Walter. And what we understood is the following, is that in fact these inner fluctuations, they form a semi-group. That was very, very surprising. So in fact, when you talk about gauge potentials in physics, you have to know that there is a semi-group behind the scene. And this semi-group, so there is a semi-group. And the reason why there is a semi-group is that the inner fluctuations are replacing D, the line element, by the inverse line element by D plus some of this type. But what was very striking, and which was known before, was that if you take again an inner fluctuation of this thing, well, you get an expression of the same form. So inner fluctuations of inner fluctuations are inner fluctuations. Now, in the work with Walter, we understood that there was a semi-group behind. And what is this semi-group? It's a generalization of the group of inner automorphisms. So there is a semi-group. This semi-group contains the group of inner automorphisms. Okay, it contains a group of inner. But Essentially, the elements of this semigroup are expressions of the form sigma of AI tensor BI, if you want. I'm a little bit sloppy, but there is an opposite here, where the only condition is that sigma of AI BI is equal to 1. So I can show you the slides, but I don't want to spend too much time about it. I just want to say that this gave, if you want, a very good understanding of the inner fluctuations. At first, the idea was to be able to perform the fluctuations without using the what we call the order one condition, but eventually we fell on this semigroup of inner fluctuations. So if you want, now there is a perfect general framework for these inner fluctuations, and it showed us that we had to admit that the true model was not the standard model, but it had to have this algebra here. And when you compute with this algebra, what we found in the paper with Walter and Ali, what we found is that the corresponding theory was not the standard model, it was slightly bigger. So it was a theory where the gauge group was SU2 left cross SU2 right cross SU4. Okay, and this is one of the Patisalam models. This is one of the Patisalam models. And what we found, in fact, by doing the calculations and so on, exactly the right X sector, all the right breaking, and so on and so forth. And in fact, I think Ali looked this summer among various papers which models were surviving the actual test for experiments and so on, and our model is one that survives.
Excuse me, you're on record of having a prediction for the mass of the Higgs boson that doesn't agree with the experiment.
Oh, sure, okay. That's a fantastic story, so let me answer immediately, because that story is so beautiful, and because we are not good in propaganda, this story is not known. But let me tell you the story, okay? So, indeed, I mean, what happened was the following. So what happened was the following. What happened was that because we had in our model in 2006, indeed, was the same as the standard model, okay, and it had a coupling constant. It had a coupling constant which is called the scattering parameter, actually, so which is the coupling constant for the phi 4 terms, the H 4 term, if you want, in the Higgs sector, which was of order 1 at unification. So because of that, this is a well-known fact that if you impose that for the standard model, when you run it down, you will get a X mass which is of the order of 160-170 GeV. Okay, when you run it down. We had another prediction, which was the prediction of the top mass, namely because the model has few less parameters than the ordinary model, and when we run down the prediction for the top mass, we got agreement, okay? So of course it was very disappointing when in 2008, we didn't have to wait too long, so in 2008, there was a paper in physics in Chicago, I think, which was excluding precisely the type of mass that we had. So I immediately wrote a post in the blog of non-commutative geometry where I said, you know, okay, I mean, I cited Lucrèce, you know, saying it was not designed for me, it was designed for the other people. How nice it is when you are sitting on the beach to see a boat being seen. Okay. Okay, so that was the story at this time. That was the story at this time. And it turned out that then 4 years later, actually, this was in 2012. Yes, this was in 2012. Ali wrote to me an email. This was in Easter, I think. And he told me, you know, okay. So what he told me is the following. He told me there are three physics groups that actually have had the following idea, that because the standard model is not compatible with the actual, you know, Higgs mass, okay? Because if you take the standard model and you run it up, not down, you will find out that with the actual mass of the Higgs, the lambda coefficients for the phi 4 terms will turn negative, okay? So what Ali was telling me is that there were three different groups of physicists who considered seriously this problem and found a way out. And what was their way out? Their way out was to invent a new scalar field, let's call it psi, okay, which was real. It had to be a real scalar field, okay? It had to be real. And this real scalar field had to couple with the Higgs in a certain way. It had to have a term of the form psi square h square with a certain coefficient here, of a certain sign. And it had to have, of course, a psi 4 term, okay? Okay. So Ali wrote to me and he said, okay, and what happens then is the following, is that if you include this scalar field, real scalar field, it will change the renormalization group equations, and it will change them in such a way that everything works. Namely, it's compatible with the Higgs mass, okay, with the, so it lowers the Higgs mass, if you want. Yeah, yes, right, yeah, okay?
We don't know what happens.
Right, okay. Nobody cares. Okay, so now what happened was the following. Ali added one phrase. This scalar field, we add it in our paper. When we wrote the paper was written 2 years before, so there is no arguing that we had a scalar field. We had this scalar field, okay, and we had decided with Ali that it would not change the renormalization group equations and it could be fixed to its vacuum. Okay, so we had discarded this scalar field. So then we wrote a paper whose title is sufficiently significant, which is called The Resilience of the Spectral Standard Model.
Okay. Elasticity.
Well, it's not that we fine-tuned it or anything like that. What is amazing, then I looked, of course, very, very carefully, what is amazing is that the scalar field is there. It's a scalar field which is present to give the Majorana mass to the neutrinos. Okay. And we had already written that its bare mass had to be a certain value and so on and so forth. And moreover, it has the correct sign for the coupling with the Higgs, and it has the correct sign for the self-coupling. So, I mean, it's not that we are, you know, fudging or anything like that. Of course, many people, for sociological reasons, will tell you that we are fudging, but this is not the case, okay? So that was the situation for this, okay. Now, still, you know, in spite of that, there was one aspect which was bothering, and it was bothering us with Ali also, which is that this algebra we had, it's a very strange thing, this pair of algebras, for the following reason, that this algebra has dimension 16. Quaternions have dimension 4 over the reals, and 2 by 2 matrices, yeah, so it has dimension 16 real, whereas this has dimension 32 real. You see, because it's a 4 by 4 matrices of complex numbers. 4 by 4 is 16, but then you have 2 because you have complex numbers. So this looks like a very, very strange mixture of things, okay? And now what I claim is that we have found the complete answer for this. And moreover, we have found, and this is the work with Shamseddin and Mukhanov. And what we have found is the following. So it will be the full explanation for this algebra. But more than that, if you want, what was a little bit strange before is that you had to say that you start with spectral triples, so you start with AHD, okay? And somehow, you know, this was a line element, but it was not at all obvious why nature should not be content just with a line element, because after all, the action only depends on the line element and so on. And so why, what is the role of A? What is the role of this algebra A? So that was the story which was sort of missing. Okay, so if you want, the motivation was, so our goal was to show, well, this of course has been my dream for a very, very long time, to show that geometry emerges from the quantum completely naturally. And the way it will emerge from the quantum is by a generalization of the Heisenberg commutation relation. So I remind you that the Heisenberg commutation relation is just PQ is IH bar or something like that, okay? And I mean, what people have devised, mathematically speaking, from this equation is, of course, they looked for irreducible representations, they found there was only one and so on, and then they shot off to group representations. And then, okay, fine for them. But it turns out that with group representations, there is little hope to obtain arbitrary geometries, arbitrarily curved geometries, and so on and so forth. And the claim that we make with Shamsiddin and Mukanov is that you can obtain arbitrary geometries with arbitrary curvature and so on, except that the volume will be quantized. This will be the, this is what is in a quantum, okay? The volume will be quantized, and the geometry will emerge from Hilbert space, so from the quantum, from an operator theoretic equation, but it will not be a naked geometry, it will be geometry coupled with the standard model. In fact, with exactly the extension of the standard model by this algebra, okay? So that's what will happen. Now, how does it happen? It happened like this. It happened that we knew for a long time what was ds, okay? So ds is a line element, and so on. But the position variables was much more difficult to come with. So whereas if you want the line element was easy, the position variables, namely what will play the role of Q. So P, the role of P will be played by D, by the Dirac operator. But what will play the role of Q? This was quite difficult to come with. And the answer will be given by the Feynman slash. But in order to motivate the answer, I have to give you two examples. And by the way, in these examples, you will see why the non-commutative is so great in the case of the two spheres. So I will first explain very briefly how you get the geometry of the circle of length 2 pi. Okay. So how can you understand the geometry of the circle of length 2 pi from an equation? Well, the equation is what I have written. So the equation is that you have a unitary u, and with respect to the line element, it satisfies the kind of analog of the Heisenberg equation, which is given there. So it's u star d commutator u is equal to 1. Now, you will understand immediately that if I have this, I have u star du minus d is equal to 1. What does it say? It says that the spectrum of d is invariant by addition of 1. Okay? So in an irreducible representation, the spectrum of d will be consisting of all integers, of all real numbers which differ of 1 by an integer. Okay? So it will be like this. Okay? Now, what will be u? It will be the shift. Okay? And you can easily classify these representations. If you add in the j, you will find out that then you have only 1. I mean, you have the, okay? And you will be able to compute distances as I told you to compute. You will compute the space, which is the spectrum of u. It will have to be the full circle because the spectrum of the shift is a full circle. And when you will compute the distance and so on, you will find out that the length of the circle is actually equal to 2 pi for an irreducible representation. So it's, and we know that the geometry of circle of length 2 pi is unique. Okay? That's fine enough. So that's an easy exercise, but this is warm up. Now you can ask, okay, what do you do for the two sphere? Okay? And this is where non-commutativity begins to enter the scene. Because for the two sphere, what you do, you don't do anything of this type. What you do is you take your 2x2 matrices, favorite presentation of 2x2 matrices over complex numbers, okay? And now what you do is you take your 2x2 matrices and you begin to write words where you use 2x2 matrices. Well, if I was only using 2x2 matrices, I wouldn't get anywhere. I would just get M2 of C, which is a finite space. But I want to use another symbol, which I call E, and which satisfies that E is equal to E star and E is equal to E square, an idempotent, if you want. Okay? So I can now write words where I put a 2x2 matrix, my favorite choice. Okay? Then I put E, then I put another 2x2 matrix, then I put E, okay? And I write words like this. I can add these expressions, I can take sums of things of this form, and I can form an algebra, a star algebra out of it. Okay? Now the claim is that with the minor work, you can prove that the algebra that you get is the algebra of 2x2 matrices of functions over the two sphere. Okay? So it looks like you have done nothing. Okay? This algebra, of course, contains 2x2 matrices, so it cannot be commutative. Okay? But what did you gain by passing to non-commutative? You gained the fact that you now have a way to present the functions in the two sphere in a beautiful manner. You are just taking 2x2 matrices and adding one symbol, E, which satisfies these rules. Okay, that's it. And what is the general idea now? The general idea is a Feynman slash. What is the idea of the Feynman slash? That instead of giving the various momenta, like P1, P2, P3, P4, you know, normally you would give P1, P2, P3, for instance. Okay? What is the idea of the Feynman slash? Is that now you put gamma matrices, so you put like P1, gamma 1, plus P2, gamma 2, plus P3, gamma 3, and you have a single object. This object is slightly non-commutative because you use gamma matrices, but it singles out in a single expression the various components, okay, and it keeps the right stuff. So in fact, what we did with Ali and Slava, we took the Feynman slash, okay, also for the coordinates. In other words, we took the Clifford algebra, C kappa. Here I write kappa can be plus or minus one. I'm working in the even case, like in the case of the sphere. So I have a single variable. My y will be a sum, if you want, it will be y a gamma a, if you want. Y a gamma a. But it sort of encapsulates all the y a into a single entity. But we have the gamma matrices. Okay? And then, in the year around 2000, I had written some equation for the matrix of the two sphere, and also for the four sphere, and we had worked with Gianni on the quantum deformation of that equation, and it turned out that what happened was that this summer Ali came, because we were collaborators, we were working together, and what he told me is that, okay, I understood what you were telling me in 2001 or something like that, you know. But he understood in his own way, which was great because then we could go further. So then we wrote down this equation. Okay, we wrote down this equation, which is this one-sided analog of the Heisenberg commutation relation, and which is this. Okay, so what are the meaning? The meaning, of course, D commutator Y, you take the commutator with this thing of the operator D, okay. And what is the meaning of the bracket around the formula? Well, the meaning of the bracket around the formula is that you take the trace, the normalized trace, with respect to the gamma matrices. Okay? So you take the sum of the diagonal elements with respect to the gamma matrices. Okay? So if you want now, there is an equality of treatment on both things. Namely, you have the momenta, which are slashed together using the gamma matrices of the manifold, and you have the coordinates, which are slashed together using the gamma matrices, okay? And all of these things commute. I mean, the gamma matrices of the slash of the Y commutes with the gamma matrices of the other. I mean, of course, they are not mixed together, okay? They don't mix together, okay? So then we looked at this equation. We looked at this equation. We were quite happy about this equation. We knew that the sphere was working, and we knew that if we take this equation, the volume is quantized. Namely, when you look at the volume, as in my first talk, namely defined by the curve which is giving you the growth of the eigenvalues, then, as we shall see more in detail later, there is a general theorem that tells you that it will have to be an integer. The volume will have to be an integer. So it's quantized, okay? And then, okay, we looked, and one day we found the following theorem. Okay, so this is the expression for Dirac and so on. But we found a theorem which we call bubbles. And this theorem is the following. It tells you that if you take a spin Riemannian manifold of even dimension and you take the associated spectral triple, as always, okay, then you will have a solution for this one-sided equation if and only if the manifold breaks as a disjoint union of spheres of unit volume. Okay? And unit volume in Planck units. Okay? So that's what we found. I will give you the proof. And when we found that, well, we were very disappointed because, of course, the universe is not like that. You know, the universe is not a sum of little spheres of Planckian volume, by no means. And the picture that we should have in mind is this. So the picture is, you know, it's a bunch, huge bunch of little spheres of unit volumes. Okay? Okay, so that's what we had at that time. And what was the proof? What was the proof? The proof was that, you know, you take... these you compute and you compute. Okay, it's a computation really of the commutators and everything. And what do you find? You find at the end of the day, you find that the equation is the following. You find that when you compute this expectation value of y dy dy dy, you find that it's equal to the determinant of the metric multiplied by omega. And what is omega? Well, essentially, it is the pullback of the volume form of the sphere. Now, you see, if you have the equation that I had written before, if you have the equation y dy 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 equals gamma, okay, essentially, then you will, what you will find out is that the differential form, which is the inverse of the volume of the sphere, will never vanish because it will be the volume form of the Riemannian manifold. So if you want, I can show you the next transparency. Yes, so the equation actually is equivalent to this. The equation is equivalent to the fact that the pullback of the volume form of the unit sphere, okay, is given by the volume form of the Riemannian manifold. But the volume form of the Riemannian manifold never vanishes. So the pullback of the volume form of the sphere cannot vanish anywhere. What does it mean? It means that the map has a Jacobian which doesn't vanish, so it's a covering. If a map is a covering of the unit sphere, of course the manifold has to break into disjoint components for which it's a diffeomorphism with the sphere. So the manifold breaks as a sum of little spheres. Okay? So when we saw that, we said, okay, I mean, this is very bad, because what it means is that the only object that we can obtain by using this theory is a sphere. And that's what I had in 2003, I forgot, or 2001 or something like that. What I had written then was that we can always obtain the sphere with an arbitrary metric of unit volume. Okay?
Like this is the smallest sphere imaginable.
Yeah, smallest sphere imaginable, okay? So, but fortunately, this was not the end of the story. And the way things happened was the following. Then you have to go back in the pages, and you have to remember that that for the standard model, we had in fact two elements in the center. Okay, so in fact, what we investigated next. Okay, so as I said, the sphere, you get the sphere and so on. What we had was that in fact there were two kinds of quanta. Namely, these spheres that I am talking about, they can correspond to kappa equals one or kappa equals minus one. Namely to the fact that when you take the Clifford algebra, you can take the sine plus one or the sine minus one. Okay? And then what we began to do, we began to think in the following lines. You know, when you are a kid, you can play with bubbles. Okay, but you know that if you are lucky, very tiny bubbles can coalesce together, and they can form something which is huge. Okay, so we began to investigate what happens if we replace the equation, which was the one-sided equation, by a two-sided equation. And what is the two-sided equation? The two-sided equation is that we use the two kinds of quanta, and we find not y. Okay, so you see the y was satisfying y squared is equal to 1. So of course y in that case is of the form 2 times the projection minus 1. Because for an element to be of square 1 is the same as to say as 1 plus y over 2 is a projection. So y is of this form. And then there is a well-known operation which is there because of the operator j. Because before when we were writing the one-sided equation, we were not using the operator j. We are not using the real structure. And the real structure exactly allows you to write a new equation where you use not only this E, but you use J, E prime J, if you want, J inverse. And you make their product. And this is what is written here. So here, if you want, there is this 2E, G, E, G inverse, where you take this projection, E. So we wrote down the two-sided equation, and we began to study it. Okay. The first thing that we found out is that if we are in dimension 4, if we are in dimension 4, and if we look at the algebras which are obtained, okay, which are the Clifford algebras, okay, which are the Clifford algebras, but you have to understand that you are in dimension 4, but you are writing a Clifford algebra in dimension 5, because when you write y squared equals 1, which is the equation of the sphere, you have 5 y's, so you have 5 gammas. Okay, so you are in fact looking at the Clifford algebra in dimension 5 and at its irreducible representations. Okay, now if you look at the Clifford algebras in dimension 5, you will find out that the Clifford algebra in dimension 5 for 5 pluses, plus, 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 and the Clifford algebra with 5 minuses, minus, 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 are the following. The algebra with 5 pluses is M2 of H plus M2 of H. And the algebra with 5 minus is M4 of C. Okay? But moreover, we are taking an irreducible representation, so the fact that you have two copies of M2 of H, there is only one which survives. Okay? So in fact, what we find is that when we write down the slash of our elements, okay, we find that the non-commutativity is exactly the right one. Namely, there is a copy of M2 of H and a copy of M4 of C. And they have different dimensions. What is the reason why they have different dimensions? The reason is the following, that if you take M4 of C, it has two different irreducible representations. They correspond to whether it's C linear or C antilinear. Exactly as M2 of H plus M2 of H has two irreducible representations according to which piece you take. Okay? So already there, okay, you know, we had an enormous hint. Okay? But then we continued, and what we found is that now the equation, which before was this impossible equation saying that the Jacobian was everywhere invertible, okay, now the equation was different. What the equation was telling is that because you have two y's, okay, this was corresponding to the two elements in the center, if you want, okay. So now because you have two y's, what happens is the following. Now what happens is that you have your manifold M. And what you are looking for, you are looking for two maps to the sphere, y plus and y minus, okay, to the sphere, S4, okay? And the condition is not that each of them is a covering. Of course, if that was the case, you know, you wouldn't get anywhere. The condition is that if you pull back the volume form of the sphere by each of them, and you add these two things, the sum never vanishes, okay? The sum never vanishes. So the correct statement is the following. So, okay, the correct statement is a theorem that for n equals 2, but n equals 2 is easy, or n equals 4, then the solutions of the two-sided equation, okay, first of all, they imply that the volume is quantized, and the reason why the volume is quantized is because the volume now will happen to be the sum of the degrees of the map y plus and the degree of the map y minus, so it will be an integer. And the second thing is that a solution exists if and only if the volume belongs to a certain invariant, which I will show you now, and which then we spent a lot of time determining. So what is this invariant? This invariant is the following. You take a manifold M of dimension 4, but you could take a manifold of arbitrary dimension, and the invariant that you define for this manifold is the following. You consider, so it's a purely geometric problem, you consider a manifold M oriented, and you consider the pair of smooth maps to the sphere such that when you pull back the volume form of the sphere by one of them, and you add the pullback of the volume form of the sphere by the other, you get a differential form which vanishes nowhere. You see, if I had only one map, this would say that I have something which is a covering of the sphere. But I'm not assuming that. I have two maps now. Okay, I have two maps. Okay. So, what is the invariant? The invariant is given by the sum of the degrees of these two maps. So, in other words, you are supposed to find two maps to the sphere and add their degrees. Okay, but of course, these two maps are such that when you pull back the volume form of the sphere, the sum of the two doesn't vanish. Okay. Okay, so this was the problem. This was the problem. And we first made sure that in a number of examples it was okay, it was working, but that was not enough. And then I began to write to my geometer colleagues, okay, and in particular to Simon Donaldson, who really gave a very important hint, which I will explain later. But so the Well, what we did prove, and this was not difficult, was to prove that in the case of low dimension, so if you look at dimension 2 and 3, it was not difficult to show that then you get all integers above a given integer in this quantization condition for the manifold. So this we knew already. This we knew already. But of course, the physics has to do with dimension 4. And let me first explain why the problem is quite difficult in dimension 4. Let me explain geometrically why the problem is quite difficult in dimension 4. So what was the idea to construct these maps? What was the idea, for instance, for dimension 3? Okay, so the first idea for dimension 3 was the following. You see, we have a manifold M, okay? And, I mean, we want to construct a map, so let's say a dimension 3, okay? And you want to construct a map to the 3-sphere. You want to construct two maps to the 3-sphere in such a way that the sum of the two Jacobians will never vanish. Okay, so what is the first idea? The first idea is to use a construction which is due to Alexander. And which goes back to the 1920s. Okay, and so what is the idea of Alexander? The idea is that if you have any manifold, let's say compact-oriented, so take M to be compact-oriented, okay, so then the theorem of Alexander is that then there exists a ramified cover, a ramified covering from M to the sphere, Sn, so this is valid in any dimension, okay, where the ramification occurs in codimension 2. You see, I mean, this is quite a strong thing. Why? Because normally, if you consider a map to the sphere, a generic map will ramify where the determinant vanishes. But the determinant, where it vanishes, normally it defines an hypersurface because it's one real equation. So one real equation normally defines an hypersurface, okay? So, I mean, at first you think you are stuck. You are stuck because you would have ramification in codimension 1. But Alexander was able to do ramification in codimension 2. And what is the idea of Alexander? It's so beautiful that I want to explain it because it's essential for the rest. So what is the idea of Alexander? The idea is the following. The idea is that, okay, so you triangulate your manifold. Triangulate N. Okay, so you will have triangulated M, okay? So there will be some triangulation, something like that, okay? Okay, now, actually, this is not in Alexander, this is an improvement which was done by much later. But so now what you do is you do a refinement of this triangulation. You do a barycentric subdivision. So you take a barycentric subdivision of this triangulation. Okay. So you take a barycentric subdivision, and now what you do is you color the triangles in the barycentric subdivision according to the following. You see, when you take the barycentric subdivision, you can index the vertices of the barycentric subdivision by the dimension of the faces which they are contained in. So for instance, this would be 0, this would be 1, and this would be 2, okay? Now you see that if I take this other triangle here, 0, 1, 2, the orientation of that triangle agrees with the orientation of the plane, but the orientation of that triangle does not agree. So I will paint this one in black, and I will leave this one in white. And I keep going this way, okay? And not surprisingly, it matches. So in other words, now, in the overall triangulation, I have black and white triangles. Moreover, each of the triangles has a well-indexed vertices, okay? And now what you do is you write a little sphere here, and you write this little sphere as the sum of two triangles, okay, glued together, okay? And so this is my black triangle, okay? And this is my white triangle. So this is just the double of a single triangle, okay? And this is a sphere, of course. It's a sphere, okay? So now what you do is you map the black triangles to the black part of the sphere, simplicially. It's unique, it's well-defined. And you map the white triangles to the white part of the sphere, okay? And you get, obviously, a cover of the sphere, okay? And this cover is not ramified on the faces of the triangles, but it's ramified on the codimension 2 skeleton, okay? So this is the Alexander construction. And, I mean, what is the miracle between us? What is the miracle? Well, the miracle is that if you take the map z goes to zn in complex numbers, the Jacobian of this map will be giving you two equations. The fact that the Jacobian of this map will vanish will give you two equations, two real equations. So in fact, it will define a codimension 2 subset. Okay, that's the idea. And you cannot get something which is of higher codimension. What is the reason? The reason is because in codimension 2, the complement of a point is not simply connected, and that's the origin of monodromy. And if you would work in an higher codimension, this wouldn't make any sense, okay? Because it would be simply connected. So this is the idea. This is the idea. And what do we get from this idea when we are working in dimension 3? Well, you see, it's quite easy to finish in dimension 3 because... Yeah, because if we are in codimension 3, well, in dimension 3, sorry, you see, what will happen is that we shall take our manifold, M, and it will ramify over S3 by some map phi, constructed by Alexander. And then the ramification set, sigma phi, will be a knot in M. I mean, it will be something of dimension 1, okay? But of course, by genericity, we can perturb phi to a phi prime, okay, in which the knot for phi prime, so the sigma phi prime, will be disjoint from sigma phi, okay? Just because if you have, you can compose with a diffeomorphism of the manifold M if you want, okay? I mean, it's a very easy fact that if you take any dimension 1 subset of a manifold, okay, in dimension 3, then you can move it disjointly to itself by a diffeomorphism. In fact, the set of diffeomorphisms which achieves that is the density delta by Baer's theory. Okay, so that's very easy to see. So in dimension 3, it's easy. What about dimension 4? Well, dimension 4 is dramatically difficult. Why? Because in dimension 4, codimension 2 means dimension 2. It means a surface. And two surfaces in dimension 4, they do intersect. Okay? So we were quite worried. I mean, okay, we could handle very simple cases and so on. And I mean, we could handle the case of, for instance, a three-manifold cross S1. And then we were happy because we were saying, after all, you know, to do physics, that might be enough, and so on. But that was not quite satisfactory, okay? So, as I said, you know, then I gave the problem to several people, and Jean-Claude Sikorav and Bruno Sevenek in Lyon, they found a necessary condition. They found a necessary condition. And I can tell you why this is a necessary condition. It's very easy to see why you have this necessary condition. You see, let me explain the proof of this statement. So what is the proof of this statement? I want to leave this. Let me explain the proof of this statement here. So why do you have a necessary condition? Well, You see, you will have two open sets in the manifold M, whose union certainly will be the whole of M. And these two open sets are the open sets where each Jacobian doesn't vanish. So you will certainly have that M is equal to U plus union U minus, where U plus is a set of points where the Jacobian of phi plus is different from zero, and U minus is a set of elements where the Jacobian of phi minus is different from zero. Okay? Certainly you have that the manifold M is covered by two open sets. Okay? Now, on each of these open sets, what do you have? You know that the sphere is stably parallelizable. Its tangent bundle, when you add to it a trivial bundle, is trivial. Okay? So what does it mean? It means that the characteristic classes of the tangent bundle viewed as real classes, I mean viewed as a real vector bundle, which are the Stifel-Whitney classes, have to vanish. So what do you know? You know that when you consider the tangent bundle to M, since it is a pullback of the tangent bundle of the sphere on U plus and of the tangent bundle of the sphere on U minus, okay, it will have the fact that the Stifel-Whitney class W2 here will be expressible in terms of the Stifel-Whitney class of the sphere, and similarly here. But because it's covered by two open sets, what it means is that the square of the Stifel-Whitney class W2 has to vanish. Okay? That's a simple exercise, okay, that you can see using Chech cohomology or something like that. You have a cover by two open sets, and on each of them you have vanishing. So what they got is that W2 square is equal to zero. Now, this is not true for projective space. So if you take CP2, okay, if you take CP2, CP2 doesn't have W2 square is equal to zero. Okay, so for instance, so if you, what does it mean? It means that if you take CP2, the set of quantum values of a volume is empty, okay, because you don't have a pair of such things. Okay. But at the same time, we were thinking very hard about our problem, and we made the conjecture that the set of quantum values is non-trivial as soon as the manifold is spin. Now, what does it mean to be spin? It means W2 is equal to zero. And so, of course, it implies W2 square is equal to zero. Okay? Okay, but then we had to prove it. And this is where the real geometric stuff enters. And so there is a key lemma. You see, what we were trying to do here was a little bit too simple because we were using the same idea for phi and phi prime. So now the new idea will be that instead of using the same idea for phi and phi prime, one will use a different idea for phi and for the other one. Okay? And I mean, this came through a correspondence with Simon Donaldson, which we acknowledge, of course, in the paper. And there is a crucial lemma. There is a crucial lemma, which let me show you what it is. So the crucial idea now is to use a different idea for phi and phi prime. And the crucial lemma is the following. So first of all, the theorem is the following. The theorem is that if you take a smooth, connected, oriented, compact spin for manifold, then the set Q of M contains all integers which are bigger than 5. Okay, and for physics, of course, this is fine because, of course, we look at Euclidean space-time and it's spin. Of course, it's not at all arbitrary. Okay, so how do you prove this? Okay, so I will come back to this picture. So this is a picture of the construction of Alexander in the case of dimension 2. Okay, so I hope you see what happens. What happens is that you have these triangles, black and white. You have the sphere, which is the union of two triangles. And you have the construction, okay? And you can see very clearly that it's ramified only around the vertices of the triangulation, okay? Okay, so what is the basic lemma? Basic lemma, which is quite nice, is the following, is that now you start with a single map. So you consider a map phi from your manifold N to S4, okay? And of course, using Alexander and so on, you can assume that this map is ramified only in codimension 2. Okay? So what will happen now is that your map is there, and so you have your manifold of dimension 4, you have the manifold M, and there will be some subset where it's ramified. So this is sigma phi. There will be some subset where it's ramified. So the first idea, which we were using in dimension 3, was to try to find another map which ramifies in a different place. Okay? Then you add the two maps. Okay? Okay. Now, what is the idea here? The idea is quite different. The idea is that, after all, the whole problem is around where it ramifies. Okay? And the idea is that now we shall look where it ramifies. Okay, we concentrate on where it ramifies. Now, where it ramifies, it's a set of dimension 2 now, because we are in dimension 4. So, I mean, homotopically speaking, the homotopy theory is of dimension 2. If I take a suitable neighborhood of these sets, homotopically it's dimension 2. Okay. But, I mean, geometrically speaking, it's a manifold of dimension 4, but it's an open manifold. Okay, it's an open manifold. But you see, now there are fantastic results of the theory of immersion theory from the work of Smale. And, I mean, the amazing result from the work of Smale, but which was actually proved by Poincaré as a corollary of the work of Smale. So there is the following theorem, which is due to Poincaré. But let me put Poincaré's mail because it really comes from the idea of mail. So what is the theorem? The theorem tells you that if N is an n-dimensional manifold, which is two things. First, open. So not compact. Okay, open. Second, parallelizable. So it means its tangent bundle is trivial. Then there exists an immersion J from the manifold N to Rn with the same N. Okay? Now you cannot remove the fact that it's open because if you take the circle S1, it's certainly parallelizable, but you cannot embed it in R. Okay, so it has to be open, okay? It has to be open, but it's an amazing fact that it's enough for the manifold to be parallelizable. So, you know, it's very hard to imagine how you can do that, but then you can immerse the manifold in Rn, okay? That follows from general results of the homotopy theory, okay? But it's a deep result, it's quite a deep result. How are we going to use this, okay? We are going to use this by looking at these neighborhoods. So we look at these neighborhoods, okay? They are manifolds of dimension 4. They are open by construction. Okay, they are open by construction. But why are they parallelizable? Well, they are parallelizable because they are homotopically of dimension 2. Okay, now they are homotopically of dimension 2, but what does it mean? It means that their tangent bundle, okay, up to homotopy theory, is entirely coming from the skeleton of dimension 2. So the only invariant of the tangent bundle is coming from W2 of the tangent bundle. Now, W2 of the tangent bundle is coming from W2 of the manifold. And the manifold is spin, so it's zero. More precisely, you have to be much more careful. I mean, you have to say the manifold is spin, so you can lift the tangent bundle from SO4 to spin 4. Okay? And now spin 4, if I am correct, as a space is three connected, B spin 4 is certainly two connected for sure, okay, I mean, by large, okay? So when I consider the map, the classifying map from this two skeleton to B spin 4, I get that it's homotopically trivial, okay? So these manifolds are parallelizable, and because they are parallelizable, we can apply the theorem of Poincaré. So by applying the theorem of Poincaré, what do we get? We get a bunch of immersions, psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, from these open manifolds to R4. Okay? Now we can adjust, of course, the orientation so that they preserve the orientation, these various immersions. Okay? And moreover, I claim that we can extend the partial immersions that you get from psi 1, psi 2, psi 3 to a map, which is not an immersion, of course, which I will call psi, and which will go from the manifold M to R4. Okay? How do you extend this map? You extend this map because you can extend any function, so you extend the coordinates, if you want. Of course, you can extend any function from this subset of M to a smooth function to the entire space. Okay? So you extend the coordinates and you get a map, psi, from M to R4. Now what do? You are not finished. Now what you know is that the Jacobian of psi will be positive and not vanish on any of these open sets. Okay? But it might be too large. Now what I want to do, I want to look at phi star of the volume of the sphere plus psi star of the volume of the sphere. Okay? I don't control psi. But what do? I rescale now psi. I put a psi lambda, which I rescale by lambda here. When I rescale psi by lambda, okay, I don't change the fact that the Jacobian is positive, but I make the Jacobian of psi as small as I want outside this open set here. Okay? And because the Jacobian of phi star of alpha is strictly positive on this complement, I can make it so small that the sum of the two will not vanish. Okay? Just by rescaling. If you are worried by the volume form of R4 as compared to the volume form of the sphere, I mean, they are comparable because, you know, I am in the bounded subset of the R4. Okay? So that's what you get. You rescale. So it's a very tiny correction. It's a very tiny correction. It's like, when you have a tire which is a punch in a tire, you put a little rust in. So this is what we do here, okay? This is what we have done here. We have put this little thing added so that when you take the sum of the two things, we get something which is non-vanishing. Okay. So with this construction, okay, what one can do actually, one can prove that every number which is bigger than five. This is what we prove in the paper. But in fact, Dennis Sullivan, I had written to Dennis Sullivan, he didn't get my mail, he got it only recently, and as he was saying in an email correspondence, one can actually do it with M equals 4. So in fact, the best integer, I mean, the integer that you can take is actually equal to 4. What does it mean? It means that you can reconstruct any topology by two maps to the sphere, okay? Any topology which is spin, sorry, by two maps to the sphere, and the degree is any number which is bigger than 4, okay? Okay. So what does it tell us? Well, it tells us that we now should have a good handle, a first shot at quantum gravity. And why? What does it mean? You see, well, first of all, one has to ask what you should expect from quantum gravity. Well, you see, for me, when I see many people trying to do quantum gravity and only using gravity and then saying at the end of the day we shall have to add matter, but okay, you know, this is... I don't believe that. I'm sorry. What I believe is that quantum gravity is something that should explain the matter content of physics. Wait a second. Okay, so it should certainly explain that. Okay, it should certainly explain the matter content of physics. And it should be given by something simple, and it should be given by something quantum, of course. And what is a quantum, after all? I mean, the quantum is something that people who are doing quantum optics fight with every day, and which has to do with Hilbert space. I'm sorry, you know, it's not a fancy of the mind, it's not a fancy of the mathematics. No, it's a reality, okay? Now, the idea is the following. The idea is that the equation that we have written, is an equation which is such that when you will consider a four-manifold, so on, okay, with the standard model content and so on as before, it will give you an irreducible representation of this equation. And the general idea that we have is that instead of studying irreducible representations of the Poincaré group and so on, okay, somehow quantum gravity should be based at the particle level to irreducible representation of this equation. Okay, so that's the idea. Now, so there are mathematical reasons for that and so on. Now, how do you reconstruct the manifold and how do you see how things happen? It turns out that there are two deep, quite deep mathematical results that tell you why out of the product of two spheres, because after all, you know, as we saw, the solutions of the equation were given by two maps to the sphere. Now, two maps to the fourth sphere is the same thing as a map to the product of S4 by S4, okay? Which should have Planck size, okay? So it's this. Okay, so the first question is that how is it possible that you will get something of dimension 4 out of a map to something which has 8 dimensions? Namely, you will have 8 variables, if you want, in the equation, but you get out something of dimension 4. And the second thing is, how can it be true also that the volume of the space that you would consider will be quantized? That's the answer to the cosmological constant, of course, okay? Because the volume is the cosmological constant problem, okay? So now it turns out that there are two quite deep mathematical theories which are behind the scene. First of all, why do you carve out something of dimension 4 out of something of dimension 8? Well, the reason comes from the metric dimension I was talking about and the fact that the growth of the eigenvalues of the operator D are of dimension 4. So what happens, if you want, is that there are general results in non-commutative geometry that tell you that if you have bounded commutators between certain number of operators commuting between themselves with an operator whose growth of spectrum, so which is the inverse of an infinitesimal, and whose growth of spectrum is like in dimension 4, then the Hausdorff dimension of the joint spectrum of these operators is at most 4. Okay. So that's how you carve some object of dimension 4 out. This is a very deep result in operator algebras. The fact that if the commutator is bounded with such an operator, the Hausdorff dimension of the joint spectrum is at most 4. Okay. So this is how you carve something of dimension 4. The second thing is, why is the volume quantized? So why is the volume quantized? This is the index theorem. This is the index theorem, but it really goes back to quite a long time ago. And I can write for you the equation that actually does it, because it's so important. So what is the idea? The idea is that the volume of the manifold, as I showed in my first talk, is measured by the parameter for the parabola in dimension 2, or more generally by the growth of the eigenvalues. And it's given by the logarithmic divergence, which is defined by this symbol, of the line element to the power minus n, so let's say minus 4. Okay, so that's the volume. Said in other words, this is the leading term in the spectral action. Okay, this is the leading term in the spectral action. Why is that quantized? What is the reason why this quantity can be quantized? Well, the reason is that you rewrite this quantity as follows. You write it at integral of the square of the chirality operator times d to the minus 4. And of course, this is equal to 1. Okay. Now, you replace, so you rewrite this as integral of gamma times the, now gamma, because of the equation, was written as z dz to the power 4. Okay, and times d to the minus 4. And by a lemma, which I passed very quickly, this z dz was equal to a sum of two terms. It was equal to y plus dy plus, if you want, to the power 4, plus y minus dy minus to the power 4. Y minus to the power 4. Okay, so in fact, it's enough to show that when you consider integral of gamma, so I don't have to put the z, it's enough to show that integral, the logarithmic divergence of gamma times, let me put y for general terms, dy to the 4, and with a bracket here, times d to the minus 4, is quantized. Okay, and that follows from the index theorem. And if you want, the idea is the same as the idea why the Heisenberg commutation relation don't have a representation in finite dimensions. Okay, this is the same idea. And it goes back to my old book of 1994, in which what I had done, this is where cyclic homology enters in the scene, what I had computed at the time was the Chern character in K-homology. So the Chern character not only exists in K-theory, but it also exists very importantly as a map from K-homology to cyclic cohomology. Okay, in general, it's quite hard to compute this chain character in local terms. I mean, this is like the Atiyah-Singer index formula. But it turns out that in the particular case where we are, namely for the a projection given by, you see, y is equal to 2e minus 1, where e is a projection, okay, where e is an idempotent satisfying e squared equals e star. And it turns out that for a y, which is the type that we used, namely for a y which is of the form ya gamma a, where the gamma a are the gamma matrices, it turns out that the lower components of the chain character in cyclic homology of the projection E actually vanish. And this is quite a nice thing. It follows by Morita equivalence and by using the fact that the traces of the product of gamma matrices with less than n plus 1 terms actually vanish. Okay, this is how you get it. So what you get is that the chain character of this projection actually only lives in the top dimension. If you want to understand how it goes, I suppose you have some idea what is the bot element in topology. Namely, if you take a manifold, you see there is a specific bundle which is given by gluing a little disk and putting on this little disk a non-trivial bundle. But so this element is very special. It has only its chain character, which lives in the top dimension. So this is what we are doing, what we are dealing with here. Okay. So when you consider such an element, so you can prove that the chain character vanishes except in the top degree. And when the chain character vanishes except in the top degree, this means that you don't need to know the cyclic homology, cohomology class of the chain character to pair it. You just need to know its Hochschild class. So you see there is a, in the long exact sequence of cyclic homology where you have the map from HCN of A to HHN of A, which is a forgetful map I, it turns out that in our situation, you don't have to know the very difficult chain class here. You just have to know its image in Hochschild. Okay? And in my book, and in fact in the years 80s, I had computed the Hochschild class of the chain character of a spectral triple. And I had shown that this top class of the chain character was given by a simple formula. It was given by a class which is a Hochschild class, not a cyclic class. And that class is the following. It's a Hochschild cocycle, which is tau of A0 up to An. It's equal to the Dixmier trace, so the integral, the non-commutative integral, of gamma A0 dA1 up to dAn. So of course you can see the link with the formula, which is over there, times d to the minus n. Times d to the minus n. Okay. So this result, I did it in my class in the Collège de France. I put a result in my book, but I didn't put the proof. And then Gracia Bondia and Varilli wrote a book, and I gave them my notebook so that they write the proof in their book, okay, which they did. And and then very recently, Alan Carré and his collaborators wrote a new proof, which is proving better, where you prove actually convergence and so on and so forth. So if you want, this theorem has a long history, has quite a long history. But it's very delicate. It's a very, very delicate theorem because the coefficient of the logarithmic divergence is very tricky to define. It was defined by Dixmier, and it's a very tricky thing. And in that case, one can actually prove that it's unique. It's uniquely defined. So, I mean, this is a formula. This is the formula. And when you use this formula and you combine it with the vanishing of the lower chain, you end up with the fact that the pairing of the cyclic class with the chain character of E is given by this expression. And because the right-hand side is given by what we are trying to prove is an integer, and because the left-hand side is an index, so it's an integer, we get what we want. Namely, we get the required inequality. Okay? So we get from a lot of mathematics that in this abstract framework of quantum gravity, we do have integrality for the volume.
And the integer volume of the universe is 10 to the 120?
Wait a second. I have not finished. Okay. Okay. So I have not finished. Okay. Now, what happens is the following. What happens is that we get this integrality. Okay. So we get this, this is an integer. The leading term of the spectral action is an integer. And we are relieved because remember that when we wrote the spectral action, in the spectral action, there was one leading term, which was the volume. Now, this was very bothering for the following reason, that then when we were writing the equations of motion with respect to the spectral action, we were getting an enormous cosmological constant. Okay? But now that it is quantized, when you write the variational equation, it disappears. It's no longer there, because it's quantized. So when you differentiate with respect to some parameter, an integer doesn't move. I'm sorry. Okay? It's a rigid thing. So now what happens is the following. What happens is that when we write the spectral action for this model, so what is the spectral action? It's you know, the trace, it's the number of eigenvalues of the line element which are above the Planck length, let us say. Okay? That's what it is, the spectral action. So it's something which before was plagued by the fact that it had a huge cosmological term. Okay? But now, because of this quantization condition, this term no longer shows up in the equations of motion. And what do we find when we write the equation of motion? We find gravity coupled to matter, exactly as in the Einstein story. Okay. And moreover, what we find also, the second very important thing, is that now we have at our disposal, by looking at representations of these commutation relations in hyperspace, we have at our disposal all spin four manifolds. Okay, we have so we are in the Euclidean regime. We have at our disposal all spin four manifolds. Okay, they give us the standard model coupled to gravity as it was before, because we get the right algebra. You know, because now you take the algebra generated by y plus and y minus, and because we have the Clifford algebra, they will generate exactly the m2 of h and the m4 of c, which we are missing for the standard model. Okay, that's fine. That's all fine. But now you can ask, you know, exactly your question. Okay. Now, you see, now there comes the central question, which I think has been in the mind of physicists for so many years, which is, how can the universe be so big in Planck units? Thank you. Okay. And I didn't have the time when I prepared my talk to make, to extract the video from YouTube, but you can imagine, I'm sure. Okay. So what is the idea now? The idea is the following. The idea is that we have two Planck spheres. Okay. They are of Planck size. Okay. Okay, each of them is Planck size. And we have these maps. We have this map to this product of two. Okay. So this is an eight-dimensional space, but very, very tiny. Okay. And now our space-time is folded. It's folded, okay? And it unfolds. So the idea is like exactly like a butterfly, which is unfolding from its cocoon. And the size of the space-time that you get, Euclidean space-time that you get, is the degree of the map, the sum of the degrees of the two maps, okay? Now, okay, the beauty is the following. The beauty is that, you see, there is a clear meaning for the e-folding in this picture. Where is the e-folding coming from? The e-folding is coming from the fact that you have self-maps of the sphere which have a given degree. Let us say degree 2, okay? So what I can do now, I can compose a map with this self-map of the sphere. And what will happen? What will happen is that the degree of the map will be multiplied by 2. It's not that I will add 2 to the degree. No, it will be multiplied by 2. So what I am saying here is the following, that there is a very geometric model for the volume of the space-time to be geometrically increasing, which is, you know, what people believe in inflation or something like that. And that somehow, if you want for instance, when I was showing this picture, when I was showing the picture of the torus, you know, when I was showing you this picture, yes, so this picture of the torus, you can see very clearly in this picture of the torus how large the degree. So you have to think of the cells as being of Planck size, Okay? The cells are Planck size. Each of them is Planck size. But they are coalesced together, exactly like these little bubbles are coalesced together to form an immense space. Okay? And the degree of the map is given exactly by the number of white and black triangles. But they are coalesced together. There is no longer, they are glued together by the construction that I showed you. So if you want now, the general idea is that one could try to base quantum gravity on this picture. And that's what we are trying to do with Ali and Slava. One could try to base quantum gravity on this picture, but at least there is a requirement which for sure is fulfilled. And this requirement is that we get not only gravity, but we get gravity coupled with matter in a way which, you know, exactly fits actually with what we see. And you could argue, you could say, okay, well, you don't get a standard model, you get a little more because you get this M2 of H and M4C. Okay? But actually, by discussing with physicists, I found out that this is a minimal asymptotically free extension of the standard model. So from the point of view of physics, it's a very, very satisfactory extension of the standard model. And it's broken at a very large scale. I mean, it's broken at like something like 10 to the 11 GeV. So I mean, there is no conflict or anything like that with the actual theory. So how to proceed mathematically? Of course, now there is a clear path, because now what we are dealing with, when we are dealing with solutions of these equations, we are dealing with a matrix model, because we are dealing with operators in Hilbert space and self-adjoint operators in Hilbert space satisfying some equations. So we are dealing with a matrix model. So the next step should be to, you know, try to understand at the matrix model level how the theory develops. But roughly speaking, I mean, you know, the idea is that you really have emergence of geometry from the quantum, exactly as from the Heisenberg commutation relations, one could have seen emergence of the reals, differentiation, and so on. But here, I mean, it's in a much wider thing, and it actually incorporates all possible geometries, so it's quite different from Heisenberg. I mean, it's something much more suitable for doing physics, I mean, for gravity and so on. Okay, so I think I will stop.